So if you just bought a DCB II for your ATX or STX, then I'll show you how to set it up. The first thing you need to do is to take off the normal eye cup. And in the box, there'll be two other parts. There'll be a ring and another eye cup with this flange over there. In this ring, if you look around, there's a little knob that sticks out, and that knob goes into this slot here. So you need to slide on that ring, slowly making sure the knob goes all the way into the slot and the rubber is flush against the metal all the way around. Then you're going to put the eye cup on, make sure it's in the right position. There we go. And then when you screw it on, it should go nice and tight. You don't need to use force, it'll screw a long way, but it's going to, there we go, clamp that ring in place. As I said, you don't need to use force, but you've got a fully functional eye cup now. Now you have the main adapter. Looks like this. Make sure that this under flap is open, and you're going to slide that on, and you can lock it in place. It's now fixed in place. In the box, you would have also had a little sled here, and the table moves back and forth. You can move it all the way back. You now need your camera, a little compact camera or a system camera with a little pancake, any camera that'll fit on there. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to screw this into the mounting thread under my camera. Just with a little force, you don't want to use too much force, but with a little bit of force you can move it on there and make sure that this little sled is parallel with the camera. It's now on in a nice position. I'm going to turn the camera on, and the lens has come out. And I can now slide it on, and with this still open, I'm just going to very roughly position it so that it's a little bit away from the lens. Underneath here is a little screw, and I can get the camera just roughly from the side. I can get it rough, but also looking at the screen, I can get it to the right height, fix the height, and then move the sled back and forth until I've got a nice vignetted picture, but in the right position in the center. I'm now going to move it back and forth until my black ring is sharp. You want a sharp vignetted ring, not a blurry that it gets darker at the edges. So a nice sharp ring, and then you can lock it in place. To release it again, you need to press the black button out, and then you can release the entire camera. Closing the lever again, it'll lock automatically back in place. Once you're there, you can zoom in just a little bit, watching here, making sure that it doesn't bang up against the ocular lens, but you can zoom in a little bit, and now I've gotten rid of all of the vignetting. If you see that you still have a little coming in from the side or from the top, or that it's not quite right, you might need to reposition it. So just to make sure you get it just right. There we go. Now I'm rid of my vignetting. So now that my camera is set up, I can flip it out of the way to observe. I've got a little button here. Push the button up and I can flip the camera up, and it'll automatically lock in place. Which means that if you are out in the field and you're looking at something and you see something that you want to photograph, you can press the button, bring it down, and it'll automatically lock in place. If you don't want that sound, of course, you can just lift it up and lock it in place like that. And now it's ready to take photos again. If you are out in the field and say it starts to rain, or it's blowing wind, you can always use the little bag that came with the DCB2. And this is a waterproof little bag. So it's now on there, it's waterproof. It means that my camera is nice and protected from the elements. Don't go swimming with it, but most of the elements it'll keep out there and keep your camera nice and protected. So we've got everything set up, but some people want to use the ocular cover, the rain cover. And you can still use that while using the DCB2. It's elasticated here. So you can just pull it on right over the adapter, or at least the sleeve, put your adapter back on, which means that if it is spitting or raining, you can use the waterproof bag here. It'll cover your camera, so keep your camera protected, and you can still use the rain guard to keep your ocular clean. If you're just starting out with digiscoping, or you have a very simple camera, you might want to try something like kids and pet mode or sport mode. And this can sometimes help because they will try and give you a faster shutter speed. And a faster shutter speed means that you can help to stabilize some of the movement that is always happening with such a long focal length. Right now we're talking about a focal length of about 1,000 millimeters, which is very, very big. If, however, you've got a camera that can do more and you want to set it up yourself, then put it onto A, or aperture priority mode. This will allow you to adjust the aperture size. And I'm going to open that all the way up to 2.8. Smaller the aperture number, the bigger the hole. The bigger the hole, the more the light, the faster the photo you can take. You'll also want to set up your ISO. ISO is basically the sensitivity of the sensor to light. So the higher the ISO number, the faster you can take a photo, but the more grain there is in the photo, it becomes grainy. Like in the old film days, when you bought an ISO 400 film, it was more grainy than a 100. So you want to try and have that as this ISO number as low as possible, but still get a fast enough shutter speed. So on this camera, I would start on an ISO of 400. And if I gotten a sharp photo, then I would reduce it down to 200 or 100 and then try. Other tricks that you should do is to put it onto macro focus mode. Macro focus, automatic focus, tends to deal better with the image that's coming out of a telescope. I am going to put it on burst mode, or actually let's try a countdown timer. I'm going to use a 2-second countdown timer. So I have looked through my telescope, found something I wanted to take a photo of, flipped down my camera. Now I notice that it's a little bit different. It's not as sharp, so I'm going to sharpen it because my eyes are not the same as a camera. So I've got it roughly sharp. I'm now going to press my finger down halfway, and the camera tries to focus, but the camera doesn't know if I'm trying to take a photo of the water lily flower or of the leaves behind it. So check to see where that focal point is. If you need to adjust it, you can fine adjust it till it's right, and then press through. When pressing through, make sure that you press slowly and not a hard. Anything that's pressed hard brings in more shake into the system. So nice and slowly through, and you've got more chance of getting a sharp photo with less shake. With a 2-second counter, it means that you can do that. Check the focus. Take your hand away, and you've got even less shake. You can also do it in burst mode, where you take a whole series of photos, or a cable release can also help to take shake away from the system. We've now got your camera set up on your spotting scope, and you can go out birding or taking photos. But the most important thing that you need to do if you want to get good digiscoping photos is to practice. visit our website online at swarovskioptik.com, and we've got a digiscoping section there with tips and tricks. But get out and practice. Practice on flowers, practice on your kids, practice on dogs or geese or ducks. It doesn't matter, just practice and you'll get better and better. So when you really need to, when you really want to take a photo, you can.